Hello everyone, my name is Naresh Imani. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Electrical Engineering at IIT Hyderabad. Welcome to Introduction to Semiconductor Devices. So as we saw in the introduction, semiconductors have evolved quite dramatically in the last 70 years, starting with semiconductor devices which was the size of buildings in 1940s and 50s, to today's technology where we are able to pack more than 1 billion transistors on a single chip of about 1 inch square. So this dramatic improvement has been possible because of various technological advances. And in this course, we would like to understand the physics of how these semiconductor devices work. So today we'll begin that journey. So the first question we ask ourselves is, what are semiconductors? Well, all of us are familiar with metals in our daily life, metals like copper, lead, gold, silver, etc. So if you apply a potential across these metals, and then measure the current, you will see that the metals carry a lot of current. They conduct a lot of current. The current carrying capability of metals is given by a quantity known as conductivity, whose units are Siemens per centimeter. So in this graph here, I have shown a few metals and their corresponding conductivities. You see that most of the metals have conductivities in the range of about 10 power 8 Siemens per centimeter. So that's a reasonably large amount of conductivity. On the other extreme, we also have insulators, which are not really good conductors of electricity. For example, plastic or diamond or glass, rubber, etc. These are all not very good conductors of electricity. And so we expect that their conductivity is going to be very small, relatively small compared to the metals. So we see that the conductivity range of typical insulators is in the range of 10 power minus 20 to 10 power minus 12 Siemens per centimeter. So we see that there is almost 20 orders of magnitude difference in the conductivity of metals and insulator. These are the extremes. So between these two extremes, there is a very broad range of materials which have intermediate conductivity. The conductivity falls in between these two extremes. The most prominent example of these semiconductors is silicon. You see in the graph here that silicon has a conductivity of about 10 power, I would say 3 here, maybe 3. And 10 power minus 5 or so. So it ranges between 10 power minus 5 Siemens to 10 power 3 Siemens per centimeter. So we have about 8 orders of magnitude difference. So whereas, your metals and insulators has a fixed amount of conductivity, the conductivity of silicon can be tuned from, this over 8 orders of magnitude by changing certain properties. We will come to that later on. So this is a very unique property of semiconductors. Also, gallium arsenide is another very popular semiconductor, so which exhibits the conductivity range from about 10 power 4 here to about 10 power minus 8. So in this case, we see that it's about 12 orders of magnitude change in the conductivity. So in essence, semiconductors are those materials whose conductivity can be modified from a highly conductive to highly resistive state. And this is one of the simplest definitions of semiconductors. In the graph here, I have also shown resistivity on the top. So resistivity is essentially inverse of conductivity. So it has a units of ohm centimeter. And we will use resistivity to denote the properties of semiconductors later in the course. So essentially, whenever the resistivity is high, the conductivity is low, and vice versa. So this is fairly simple. All right. So we understand the semiconductors have intermediate conductivity. But how does this come about? What is the origin of this property? So to understand that, we'll have to look at the periodic table. So out of more than 100 elements in the periodic table, most of the important semiconductors fall into three groups: group 3, group 4, and group 5. As you might have studied, group 3 elements are those elements which have 3 electrons in the valence shell, in the outermost shell. Group 4 are those which have 4 electrons in the outermost shell. And group 5 are those which have 5 electrons. So if you look at group 4 elements, wherein the silicon falls in group 4, you see that silicon has an atomic number of 14, and it exhibits semiconductor. It's a very good semiconductor. Similarly, germanium is another very famous semiconductor. And recently, carbon has, one of the allotropes of carbon has been shown to exhibit very interesting properties, which is called as graphene. So these are all called as elemental semiconductors, which means the semiconductor consisting of only one type of atomic species, silicon, germanium, or carbon. In addition, you could also have what are called as 3-5 semiconductors. So what I will do is I will take one element from the group 3 and I'll take another element from group 5 and form a compound out of it. So for example, I can take gallium from group 3 and arsenic from group 5 and I can form a compound out of it. If I do that, it turns out that even these exhibit semiconducting behavior. So the reason for this is, if you look at the periodic table, immediately we see that gallium has 3 electrons in the outermost shell. Arsenic has 5 electrons. So if you look at the number of electrons in the outermost shell per species, so here you have 2 species, you know, gallium and arsenic, you know, 2 elements you have. So the number of elements, number of electrons per atomic species is basically 8/2, and so it turns out to be 4 electrons again. So even when you have a combination of this gallium and arsenic, we are actually having 4 electrons in the outermost shell. And it is not really surprising that, you know, all the semiconductors have these 4 electrons in the outermost shell. We'll see why it is later on. You could also have various other 3-5 semiconductors. For example, I can form a compound between, you know, indium and arsenic. I can form a compound between gallium and phosphorus, and so on. I mean, you can have various compounds. So these are known as compound semiconductors. So basically, there are more than one atomic species. So some examples are given here. Out of all these compound semiconductors, gallium arsenide is the most popular one or a famous one. And we will talk about compound semiconductors. These are very, very important for optoelectronic devices. And we will talk more about them in the last 2 weeks of the course. Till then, we will focus on elemental semiconductors, namely silicon and germanium. And mostly silicon. Germanium is only for comparison purposes we will use. All right. Well, I mean, you might ask, is it possible to go further out? Like, for example, can I take a group 2 element and a group 4 element? Group 6, sorry, not group 4, group 6. Can I form a semiconductor? Well, you can do that as well. So one of the popular ones here is cadmium and selenium. Cadmium selenide is a good semiconductor. So you could have various combinations, various compound semiconductors this way.